Good afternoon. Thank you all so much for coming. You know, oftentimes we think to ourselves, why bother going to an event? If you're following the news these days, unfortunately, there are all kinds of reasons that security and resilience are on your mind. There's unfortunate events like today's shooting in Kentucky, the warning we had about the tsunami off the coast, for example, of Alaska today. A lot of events going on in our society that make us think, you know, how are we ready for the next event? Are we ready for the next event? And if it happens, are we ready to bounce back for that? So with that background in mind, I'm very, very happy that our first speaker for the Spring 28 series is Professor Carrie Hirsch, who's joining us here from on campus. She's actually a Northeastern adjunct with us. Despite the fact that she went to Duke for a master's degree, which is not her fault, she has a PhD from Chapel Hill, which is fantastic, my own alma mater, and also a law degree from Duke as well. She has focused throughout her research on rituals. I found it very fascinating. She looked at the crossing the line ritual when the US Navy crossed from the equator. At the use of PMS as a defense in the American courts, and also looking at two different communities, the religious right, and also more of the New Age practice communities as well. So I think tonight's talk will be very excited. It is being taped, so just remember, if you ask any questions, posterity will know what you said. With that, please say thank you.
You know, there's a reason why it's kind of a classic anthropological topic. I mean, it's a universal. There's no community that is absent of rituals. And most of the time, we perform rituals all the time without noticing them, even. So the interest in rituals has been revitalized quite a bit recently. And I find that it's particularly interesting with respect to resilience because of the flexibility that humans have with adapting. And so often you can see rituals both as a way of sustaining how a community is, but also adjusting the rituals themselves helps to build resistance to the new changes and the new world that is manifesting. So several decades ago, as Daniel mentioned, I did research a Navy ritual, and I had a bit of insider advantage in that I have an extraordinary number of family members who are in the military, including my father, who brought back all sorts of pictures that you're going to get to see in a moment, about a rather secretive ritual when sailors cross the equator line. Now, at the end of a kind of grueling and hilarious 2 days, the participants weren't just filthy and tired, but they also had a new sense of identity, a newly kind of reified sense of community, and a much more relaxed and amused crew. And that's not an easy thing to get on a tub in the middle of the ocean 8 months engaged in warfare. So I'm going to discuss today what ritual is, what effects it can have on participants, how it produces these effects, and then how rituals can and do play important roles in the security and resilience of various communities. So when we hear the word ritual, and I should warn you, these are relatively benign photos, but there might be some photos or small videos that are, you know, a little violent or graphic. So I will give you a heads up when those pop up. Anthropologists get a little immune to the bizarre things that humans do, but not all of us have that luxury. So when we first hear of the word ritual, we think of very formalized settings with, you know, some kind of indoctrinated person following a script or a set of rules. But anthropologists see ritual everywhere. So, you know, it's not just the sacred ones, but the secular ones, and for multiple reasons. You know, we think about going to the airport as something that's not necessarily full of ritual, and yet how many of us stand in line, take off our shoes, empty our pockets, do the check, pour out the water bottles, you know, move through the gates, are wanted, et cetera, only to find out that we actually had a box cutter in our person the whole time. So the rituals aren't necessarily about effectiveness, although really ineffective rituals do tend to fade away. But rather, they're about these larger ways that we're communicating about ourselves and with each other. So ritual effects on participants can include shaping collective experience and sentiment. Whether it's to a nation or clan or some other significant group. Disciplining the bodies and minds, and that we'll see multiple examples of that. cohering societies across other divisions. This is particularly important in the Navy ritual we're going to look at, because you have an incredibly diverse group of people in the U.S. military. And in fact, this ritual, as I'm going to talk about, was one that was poised right at this moment of integration of women onto ships, and right at this moment of debate over sexual diversity in the military. And so the ritual itself is kind of expressing a resistance to both of those things. But since those two integrations, the ritual itself has changed form to reflect the difference. Has it changed in the past? For example, during after racial integration, certain elements of the ritual shifted quite dramatically. Effects can also, you know, happen on the individuals and on the participants themselves, or at the very least, or the effect itself perhaps, is providing structure around uncertainty. So importantly, rituals are both social and psychological, and if we look at them from that peculiar place that anthropologists stand, where we're both inside and outside of a community simultaneously, we can see that rituals serve multiple purposes, both conscious and subconscious. They make tangible a myriad of emotions and identities and social roles. They solidify your place in society, and they reinforce a particular sense of rightness in how the world works and what your role is in it. And sometimes they're just fun. So because of the boundlessness of human creativity, rituals take an infinite number of forms, and they can and do work in multiple ways simultaneously. But I'm going to talk today about three ways in which rituals help boost their community's resilience to stress, trauma, change, and uncertainty. First, by offering healing. Secondly, by providing some form of control, or at least an acknowledgement of a lack of control over situations. And thirdly, by tightening community bonds, identities, and worldviews in a way that helps to stabilize and bind the community. And of course, some rituals do all of these things simultaneously. But before I dive into the examples, I want to talk for a moment about what exactly constitutes a ritual or rite of passage, and how rituals function by coaxing individuals into specific roles and merging ideational systems with tangible practices. So rituals, crediting Victor Turner mostly, have particular elements to them. First of all, they are behavior that is formal, stylized, repetitive, and stereotyped. Secondly, they're performed earnestly as a social act. There might be a lot of humor involved, but everyone takes the performance of the ritual seriously, or they engage it with intent. They're performed in special or sacred places. Now, that could mean a particular place, for example, Stonehenge, right? Every year you have folks going to sacred circles at certain times of year and having particular performances. But that special place or that sacred place could be an altar in your home. It could be facing east. It could mean any number of things. They're performed at set times, and similarly, that could mean December 25th, or that could mean midnight. And they include liturgical orders, which are sequences of words and events that were invented prior, words and actions that were invented prior to the current performance of the ritual in which they occur. So one particular type of ritual that helps with transitions in particular is called rites of passage. And these are moments where societies are marking transitions. They could be natural cycles or life stages. So whenever you have a disruption to the community, whether it's the birth of a new member or the death of a new member, whether you are in agricultural society concerned about the harvest or about the planting, any type of moment when there is a change, you often find rites of passage. The content and sequence of rituals help to shape emotions in the participants as they go through these transitions, and it represents the social order in particular, oftentimes in an idealized or partial way, and often as if the rituals themselves produce or shape the social order. So I want to show a few clips, and this is where I apologize for some of the images. How many of you have seen Full Metal Jacket? Okay. So one aspect in terms of how rites of passage and rituals affect emotions is through radical resocialization. So you begin as one person with certain role in society, and you end someplace very different, Whether that means you begin single and end married, or you begin a boy and you end a man, there are lots of different ways in which rites of passage use sometimes extraordinary methods to make that transition feel very real. And sometimes some of these involve what we might just casually observe as abuse, sometimes physical, sometimes emotional, as a way of recrafting that person. Now, that's not always true. I mean, weddings, for example, don't generally tend to be fairly abusive, although it depends on the family you have there. But, you know, I'm going to show you a clip from Full Metal Jacket and then a short clip from a boyhood initiation ritual in Papua New Guinea. So this is a moment where there's an indoctrination from civilian to soldier.
You're so ugly you can be a modern art masterpiece. What's your name, fat body?
Sir, Leonard Lawrence, sir.
Lawrence, Lawrence, what, of Arabia?
Sir, no, sir.
That name sounds like royalty. Are you royalty?
Sir, no, sir.
Do you suck dicks?
Sir, no, sir.
Bullshit, I bet you can suck a golf ball through a garden hose.
Sir, no, sir.
I don't like the name Lawrence. Only faggots and sailors are called Lawrence. From now on, you're going to pile.
Sir, yes, sir.
Do you think I'm cute, Private Powell? Do you think I'm funny?
Sir, no, sir.
Then wipe that disgusting grin off your face.
Sir, yes, sir.
Well, any fucking time, sweetheart.
Sir, I'm trying, sir.
Private Powell, I'm going to give you 3 seconds. Exactly 3 fucking seconds to wipe that stupid-looking grin off your face, or I will gouge out your eyeballs and skull fuck you. 1, 2, 3.
Sir, I can't help it.
Bullshit, get on your knees, scumbag. Now choke yourself. God damn it, with my hand, numbnuts. Don't pull my fucking hand over there. I said choke yourself. Now lean forward and choke yourself. Are you through grinding?
So one of the reasons that I leave the vulgarity in there is because there are so many messages that are being received in this moment. And the vulgarity is one way of transitioning someone who very well may have been a relatively accepting and, you know, relaxed kind of person into someone with a very particular worldview. And in this case, it has to do with crafting a certain masculinity, one that is inherently homophobic, as you noticed from the language, and one that is, you know, synonymous in some ways with aggression and vulgarity. And this isn't something that we're unaware of. We've had a lot of conversations in the public sphere about toxic masculinity and about that being a problem related to other elements in society like gun violence and domestic violence and things like that. But the point is that this is the type of moment where you see the inculcation of a particular ideology. Now, if you know the storyline, you know that it goes on to then include more communal policing. So other people in his troop end up, hitting him with soap and things like that when he's not conforming. And he himself fails to make the transition, but the other men manage to make that transition and come out soldiers on the other side. So not necessarily all rituals are successful. Here you have an example of a blood initiation that is a puberty ritual marking the transition from boyhood to manhood. And one of the things that this particular group
was often brutal.
One of the things that this particular group believes, their cosmology is that women's primary bodily fluid is blood, men's primary bodily fluid is, women's is milk, men's is blood. And so you have to cleanse all of the feminine out of yourself as you transition to men. So young boys, of course, are drinking their mother's milk that came from their mother's wombs. They're contaminated with their mother's blood. And going into this rite of passage, there is a very kind of secret performance in the deep woods. And so they take these leaves, which they then scrape their tongue to let blood out. They gag themselves so that they throw up. They put them down their nose so that the blood gets let out through their noses as well. And so this is, again, where you have oftentimes a time of stress or a time of pain that is solidifying this cosmology, right? You're feeling it kind of embodied. And I won't make you watch the grosser parts of it, but you can see them kind of getting set up to do the ritual there. So the second way in which you see rituals and rites of passage shaping emotion is oftentimes through rebellion or even a particular ritual of rebellion. When you have a rite of passage, there's a point in the middle where you are in simply a liminal phase. And during that liminal phase, all of the hierarchies and the norms can be inverted or suspended. So you could think of this in part as, you know, psychologically as a way of sort of a pressure valve to release tensions or to release aggressions that you would experience the rest of the year. Certainly there are stories of medieval rites of passage or festivals or carnivals where slaves became masters for the day, masters became slaves. In this particular example, you have the Holi Festival of Color in India. Now, India has a very complicated relationship in terms of men and women and power. In one sense, there is a lot of goddess worship and there's a lot of respect for the feminine divinity. On the other hand, I think the statistic is something like between 63 and 68% of women experience domestic violence. So on a pragmatic level, violence against women is very real. So when you have the opportunity to invert or subvert that, sorry. One of the lesser known aspects of Holi is women actually taking out aggression on men. So here you have women during the festival sort of ritualistically beating men. And then you have a third element of communitas, where individuals, you know, step out of their normal role and in some senses lose their individuality. And a great example of that is the pilgrimage to Mecca, where you can see this unbelievable merging of individuals into one kind of worshipful practice. And you're supposed to walk around, you know, a set number of times, and there are ritual prayers that you do and ritual chants that you do. But definitely, it's not about you, right? I mean, you are experiencing it as an individual, but it's about feeling that connection to your community and your faith. And so you find that aspect very frequently embedded in rites of passage, where at some level, even though it might be one particular person going through the rite of passage, it's about the society at large, and it continually harkens back to that. So healing rituals are the first example that I'm going to talk about. And healing rituals are found in all societies, even biomedically oriented ones. And in part, you know, biomedicine itself is thought of as kind of secularized and I think culturally sterile in some ways, but that would be a huge mistake to believe that. It certainly came from a particular cultural orientation that continues to be perpetuated and practiced through a myriad of individuals who all share varying cultural frameworks. And so, you know, biomedicine itself has plenty of healing rituals. Actions that we take objectively do not affect change, even though we continue to do them. Whether it's, you know, there's lots in terms of childbirth, you know, there are all different examples of that. Episiotomies being done by physicians for no discernible reason, medical reason. Even the example of finishing your course of antibiotics because one person one time theorized that you had to take it for so many days or you could contribute to the creation of antibiotic-resistant bacteria. So the actual data around that is quite mixed. And so you have any, you know, removing unproblematic wisdom teeth is another example. I was just talking to a physical anthropologist. But that's really more cultural ritual than medically prescribed. So secondly, the biomedical model of healing is often ineffective. And here you have Sharon Hepburn back in the 80s saying that the effectiveness is limited in three ways. First, many conditions within the accepted defining properties of biomedicine, like physical diseases, simply cannot be treated effectively. An example of that might be Bell's palsy. There's no good current biomedical explanation or cure. But David Jones found that the Comanche healer, Sanapia, understood that disorder as a ghost sickness, and through her treatment of it, was far more effective than biomedical practitioners. So this, the second way is by concentrating on the purely physical, biomedicine really can't treat the social aspects of sickness. Now this is something a lot of physicians and medical researchers today are beginning to discuss, and you hear terms like structural violence, which actually came from medical anthropologists recognizing that you have a social framework that structures the experience of illness. Some people get it more than others. Some people get certain types of illnesses. And those illnesses themselves can manifest better or worse depending on the social structure that the person is embedded in. So third, you have cures that can only be achieved under favorable environmental and political conditions, and that definitely is related to structural violence. If these are not present, then biomedicine will be ineffective. So shamanistic rituals, while they seem very far from biomedicine, can actually tackle many of these issues much better than biomedical practices. So they oftentimes effect healing through communal engagement and very patient-centered approaches, as well as a reification of a particular social and cosmological order. So, you know, whatever the particular issue is, from, you know, a physiological one to a psychological one, you can imagine the immuno-boosting effects of being surrounded by friends and family and being told that your place in the world is good and real, right? So when it comes time to psychological issues, it's no wonder also that you find people gravitating towards more shamanistic approaches. So the Split Hermit is one film which was about a Vietnamese family who were Hmong refugees in the United States. The father is a shaman in the Hmong tradition, and he, after 17 years in the United States, he was having a really hard time emotionally with where he was. Now you could, from a Western perspective, perhaps diagnose him as having PTSD from his experiences in the refugee process, but there was also a strong influence of American culture on his children, who tended to move away and be a little snarky, quite honestly, about their father's shamanism in the light of things like pediatricians and Coca-Cola, things like that. So what happened was he self-diagnosed himself with a soul that was broken. His own soul was said to have strayed from his body. And so he had two fellow shamans enact a cure, which essentially had them bring all of his children scattered across the country to him in this huge celebration where they all, each one of them, went one by one in front and told him what a remarkable person he was and how much they loved him. And so he had estranged sons and distant family members he hadn't seen in ages come together as part of this. And at the end, it's not surprising, perhaps, that he finds joy and renewed strength and feels that his soul has returned. So Andrew Solomon, who has written The Noonday Demon, he talks a lot about global treatments for depression, and he himself has suffered from clinical depression. And so he talks about how he has engaged shamanistic practices in Senegal. I mean, there it would probably be called witchcraft for historical reasons. But nevertheless, it involved him marrying a ram, getting into bed with a ram, having the ram and several chickens slaughtered, and being doused in the blood. An entire village took a day off of farming to do this. And so they were drumming and standing around him. Women were spitting water on him to cleanse him. It was this remarkably involved ceremony, which he said, that this was, the practice was incredibly restorative in its communal approach. And it's perhaps not surprising that in places like Rwanda, which have experienced genocide and have taken years and years to recover from it in multiple ways, you have a new issue of Western biomedical doctors or psychotherapists coming into places like Rwanda wanting to help. And the Rwandans are telling them to leave. And they're saying, your talk therapy makes us relive everything. It makes us really upset, and then we don't go anywhere with it. We're re-traumatized all over the place. And so, like Andrew Solomon, they are opting sometimes for more traditional medical practices that are based on, rather than talking, working through a kind of rite of passage, a healing practice that involves drumming and movement of the body and a re-engagement of the entire community. So anxiety is another example of this. And I don't know if you've ever heard of Kuvad, but this was a Huichol Indian tribe in Mexico had by far the best method for making sure that men shared the pain of childbirth. And a woman in labor would be lying down in a hut, and her husband would sit in the rafters above her with a rope tied to his testicles. And so when the woman had a contraction, she'd pull. So I know some of you are cringing, and the rest are like, this is an awesome idea. We need to implement this immediately. And so, you know, really that had, in some senses, little to do with easing the birth of the woman. But it was, you know, it was related to that. But it was about sharing the experience with the husband. And there's also a great amount of distress and anxiety, if any of you have experienced this, with watching someone else have to suffer or watching someone else have to go through something like this. And so, you know, some anthropologists have pointed out that Lamanas really doesn't affect very much, but it gives the husband something to do, right? So it gives them kind of practices that they can engage with. Like they got a script. And I say husbands, I mean all partners who would be supporting the mother in these cases. So this relates also to the role of ritual as one in times of uncertainty. Now, George Knelch, an anthropologist who writes about a lot of different things actually, did this amazing article called Baseball Magic, where he talks about both the rituals that baseball players do, whether it's not changing their socks or eating the same chicken dinner every night before a game. And he compares and contrasts it with Trobriand Islanders. Now, the Trobriand Islanders have two different sets of rituals around fishing. One for lagoon fishing, which is relatively calm and safe, and then a much more elaborate one for deep sea fishing, which is very dangerous. So his argument is that these kinds of rituals are irrational in that there's no causal link between ritual and consequence, but they're rational in that it creates a sense of competence and control that helps you achieve a desired result. So finally, the third type of rituals that I want to talk about are ones that stabilize and bind. And in some senses, all of the ones that I've already mentioned do this, but some are less a response to trauma and engagement and more a desire to reify identity, place, worldview, general order of things, etc. One example that has come up just recently is the revitalization of beating the bounds. And this has particularly picked up in southern England. Now, beating the bounds was an old village practice where villagers once a year would go around and they would take sticks and they would literally hit the boundary line. And there's a kind of interesting legal heritage to this, a sort of establishment of property law and inheritance. So, you know, if you marked your territory, then you publicly proclaimed this to be yours. If you did not mark it, people could kind of encroach on it. So it was seen in a lot of different ways. Sometimes it was correlated also to things like agricultural practices and deeper spiritual things as well. But you know what sparked this revitalization in southern England of beating the bounds was the creation of the Channel. That's the tunnel that connects France to England. And so as Eve Darien Smith writes in Bridging Divides, she says that after the English Channel connected the formerly physically isolated English Isles to the European mainland, there was this resurgence of interest in village ceremonies, and beating the bounds was a particular one that got picked up and re-invoked. And she said you could kind of dismiss this as merely fun if it weren't for the particular political and social moment that precipitated it. So with the construction of the Channel as it was developing, there were all these new fears that the British had about rabid dogs coming through the tunnel and infecting the whole island with disease, and all these narratives about contagion. And so it's not surprising then that you have a ceremony that's about marking your territory and reestablishing a kind of traditional sense of yourself at the local level, that this would manifest right at this particular political moment. You also have moments of stabilization after incredible rending of past tradition. And the Virgin of Guadalupe in Mexico is an example of this. Right at this moment, post-colonialism, when the Spanish had occupied Mexico, there was, an insurgence of missionaries who are very forcibly converting the Mayan practitioners to Catholicism. And instead of a kind of clean conversion, as you would, you know, it doesn't, when you go to the Virgin of Guadalupe ceremonies and festivals, it doesn't look like Rome, right? It's something new. And it's because of this fusion, this religious syncretism, that blended the local practices. And there's a whole backstory to the Virgin. There was a Mayan goddess who would frequently appear on this particular hill. And after colonialism, the Virgin Mary was said, wearing the cloak and the symbols of the same goddess, appeared on the same hill. And so you see this kind of fusion where suddenly you have this appropriation of a new religion that was being forcibly put on, made to fit more comfortably. So lastly, I'm going to talk a little bit about the crossing the line, as promised. Now, there's a lot of reasons why this started, but it was several centuries ago that Northern Europeans were beginning to travel the world in new ways and were more routinely crossing the equator. And as a result, there were all these dangers that came up with that. I mean, have you ever seen those 400, 500-year-old ships? Like, you wouldn't travel a lake in them. They're tiny, they're dangerous, and they were traversing areas that were relatively unknown to them. There are places around the equator where you could get stuck in the doldrums, and you could literally starve to death, because unless you had enough power to row your way out, neither the wind nor the current was going to move you anywhere. So between the doldrums and then the kind of imagery of flipping your world upside down by going on the southern side of the equator, there's no surprise that rituals began forming around crossing this imaginary line. Now, this particular example that I'm going to show you is from the early 90s, and it was during the Gulf Wars. And it was before all the controversy kicked up around it. There were some videotapes that were released to a local news station in San Diego, and lots of consequences afterwards. But I'll give you a brief rundown of this ritual and why I think it's important. So the purpose of this is to convert uninitiated polywogs into shellbacks. And the first thing that happens is weeks before the actual conversion, you have this separation out of polywogs from shellbacks. If you've gone through the ceremony, then you have a card that you keep in your wallet. I've had people say that that card is more important to them than their marriage certificate. And certainly I can see the consequences for losing that would be pretty dire. So you have these kinds of posters would be put up and lots of threats and insulting subpoenas and things like that handed out. Now, the day before the crossing the line, you have someone dressed as Davy Jones coming up to announce that you are trespassing in the royal domain. So you have this also strange fusion between kind of sailor folklore and Greek and Roman imagery. So King Neptune actually approaches the ship and sort of is the one who takes over the ceremony the next day. Before that, however, you have this entry into the liminal space that is the middle of a rite of passage. And you have men becoming animals and men becoming women. So you have wild dog auctions frequently where you auction off men dressed as animals in order to raise money for particular causes. And then you would make the animals fight each other, bark at each other, hump each other, do all sorts of egregious actions that you would never normally see during daily life. The Wild Queen pageant was another place where and keep in mind that all these men packed all this stuff like 4 months before. Right? They packed the fake breasts and the fishnet stockings and the high heels. They didn't just pick that up in like the ship's store. So they're really in it to win it. So one member from each department would show up dressed in women's clothing, and it would be a kind of mix of a striptease and this, humorous performance to try to be the most outrageous and most convincing woman. Now, it's important to note that during the liminal phase, you have all kinds of inversions, but at the same time, there's always a sense in the back of your mind that life's going back to normal soon. So there can be consequences, as there were for the person who won this one, who was so convincing as a woman. They ended up transferring off the ship among a lot of rumors several weeks later that he was gay. And remember, this was back in the early 90s, and it was not policy to accept gay sailors and officers into the military. day, the men are awoken rather rudely, and they are fed from a trough, and they have to usually wear some sort of, you know, crazy outfit that puts them into that communitas state of mind where they're just undifferentiated. And then one by one, they come up and they have to kneel before the court of King Neptune. So as they kneel, of course, they're accused of being a polywog, they're found guilty, and then they're sentenced to all different kinds of punishments. And that could include a visit to the royal toilet, where they have water shot up their nose. It can include a visit to the royal dentist or doctor, where they have nasty stuff smeared in their mouth, a visit to the royal executioner. And then you also have, and the next picture is a little bit sexually graphic, just to warn you. You also have all these inversions in terms of what's appropriate. So you have men who are put in the stockade and they're beaten, or they're, you know, kind of sexually assaulted from behind, not usually in any kind of, you know, formally penetrative way, but in a way that's sort of meant to be lighthearted. But as you can imagine, people who've been through sexual trauma are not going to find anything lighthearted about that. And that's important, because remember that women weren't allowed on ships. And so for some of these things to happen to women, that would constitute some very egregious assault. I mean, not that it doesn't with men, but there's a kind of culture of masculinity that turns a blind eye, and that's part of being a man and being a sailor. You're not allowed to take these things seriously. But if women can come on the ship, they would have very real complaints of assault that would be taken legitimately. And so these kinds of behaviors are part and parcel of creating this sort of sexually bullying sense of teamwork, because you're not allowed to not laugh at them. And then you also have other imagery where here's the fattest master chief, is how it was described to me. It becomes the royal baby, and you have to eat something out of his belly button, like an oyster or a cherry or something, and then he smears your face into his stomach, and so it kind of looks like it's simulating oral sex. So at the end of this, and being that these were created in Christian nations, there's almost always some kind of birth, rebirth, and baptism. And so you have a kind of birth canal, you have a baptism in a big pool, and that's been going back for hundreds of years. Now, when your hand hits the end of this board, the whole time you've been screamed at, you know, what are you? And your response is supposed to be, I'm a polywog, sir. When your hand hits the other side of that tub, your response better be, I'm a shellback, sir, or else you have to go back and start all over again. So after the final test has been passed, that's it, there's no going back. You are now shellbacks, you never have to go through that again, and guess what, you get to be the one directing the dogs and humping the guys in the stockade the next time. So rituals show something about the values or beliefs of a group, but of course if you were to just look at this as an outsider, you'd have some very concerning notions about the military, and quite honestly, as an insider, you have some concerning notions as well. But they also show how things have changed and argued against and have been reformed through ritual action. So rituals aren't stagnant, they change with the participants. So these vary from ship to ship and definitely through time as well. In previous versions of the ritual, there was racial inversion as well. So you would find white folks on the ships dressed in blackface as police officers. And then once the racial integration on ships happened in the 1940s, that disappeared entirely because it didn't make any sense. You could have black officers, you could have black sailors of varying ranks, but they're still going to be black at the end. And so just like with the incorporation of women on ships, a lot of that more egregious sexual assault and a lot of that imagery disappears because women are still going to be women at the end. And that's important because the messages that you get through this, presumably, it's heterosexual men, and I say presumably because, of course, there's lots of a long history of what Winston Churchill calls the rum, the bum, and the lash being the three major elements of the Royal Navy. So, nevertheless, you're enacting a certain type of masculinity through this ritual that is meant to be heterosexual in the sense that once you conclude it, you are never the sort of victim of Sodom before again. You might be the aggressor, but historically that's been okay. In terms of maintaining your masculinity, and still today you can see vestiges of that as well. And what it does is it turns the uninitiated into the initiated. So the feminine, the receiver of sexual assault, the weaker, the submissive, into the masculine, the heterosexual, the strong, and the dominant. But the reason that we should really pay attention to it is, first of all, again, right at this moment of where there's so much resistance to having people of different sexual orientations or genders on the ship. You can see how ritualistically the worldview is clicking into place of a certain type of world, a certain way of being, one that is kind of oppressively masculine in certain ways. And it also provides insight, however, into how groups maintain stability under stressed and uncertain circumstances. The fear was that by changing the ritual or changing the public policies, you were going to destroy the Navy. It would come apart, it would become unhinged. But in fact, what you see is the rituals themselves changed, so that the messages about who is a sailor, those now look very different. Now, that's not to say that there's an enormous amount of sexual assault happening in the military. In fact, I think there's something egregious, like one out of three or four women are going to be assaulted by a colleague in the military. And so that you can perhaps read into some of the way that the military has been defined by this very aggressive masculinity. But there's also the potential for ritual to transform that as well, to write a different cosmology and a different message. And that's why crafting new rituals is something that we perhaps should talk a bit more about. I don't know if you all recognize on the left is a Seder plate, you know, part of the Jewish tradition of Passover. And the one thing it's not supposed to be there is the orange. But the orange tradition came from this conversation in California where the mythology is that a very conservative rabbi told someone that a woman belongs on the bima like an orange belongs on the Seder plate. That's the myth that people believe, right? So in other words, no woman should be a rabbi. It would be just as awkward as having an orange on the Seder plate. So the response to that was then to include an orange on the Seder plate. So now it fits. Now we're all good. Of course, the original story was actually about a feminist who was very averse to the homophobia that she found in Jewish communities, and so she wanted everyone to take a segment of the orange and spit the pits out like you would spit out homophobia. But somehow the myth got bigger than the actual story and still survives to this day. So, you know, I have actually participated in anthropologists generally tend to be a little allergic to practicing what we witness. And I had, during my college graduation, the anthropologist in charge was like, you know, we like to study these, but we don't like to do it, so we're just going to move this along. But I found it really important to engage this personally as well. And 10 years ago, I had a collection of friends over for New Year's, and it was a pretty grim year. My husband had just survived this lengthy cancer diagnosis and was kind of all battered and missing parts of himself. I had a friend who had lost her husband at the same time, and she had a 2-year-old. And we had other friends who were survivors of various things, and we all kind of came together and created our own ritual. We wrote down everything that had happened that year on scraps of paper, and we burned them. And then we wrote everything we wanted to happen for the next years, and we attached them to balloons at midnight and let them go. Now, I know that's horribly ecologically, you know, a horrible ecological travesty, but we would have done it a little bit differently. The point was that there was something so emotionally satisfying about doing with this group of friends who had survived this, and we had transformed our intentions. You know, we had addressed things, and we had set this new path for the future. And if you look at rituals, they are so powerful in their ability to do that. And so I think they're very worthy of not only study, but of practice in a really conscious way. So as you see communities, like the Rwandans recovering from genocide, you know, other groups that have encountered colonialism, or racism, or settlement, abuse, these rituals are incredibly important. And it might be one element of resilience that you put in their own hands, their ability to craft their own healing, or their own you know, moving forward. So thank you very much. That's
time for questions, so feel free just to raise your hand and catch us on the call. And after that, we have a reception downstairs. We do rituals of social engagement and food, so please stick with us for 2 more minutes. We'll go downstairs the second floor afterwards.
And I wish I had this photo because while they had a Wog Queen pageant, they also developed a Wog King pageant. So they had the kind of cross-dressing of women sailors into men's clothing. But at the same time, like, the winner just dressed in a guy's sailor's outfit, which, and the picture that was fantastic because it was the two winners walking away, and the woman dressed as a man was grabbing behind of the man dressed as a woman. And so it both did and did not change anything, you know, kind of reinforced the hierarchies and the relationships at the same time that it was poking fun of them. So I also have friends in the army who were going through blood winging, which is where they take a pin, like when you get your paratrooper pin, you have to stand there and they put the pin on you without the back, and then each member of your crew comes by and pounds it into your chest, wiggles it around. And so she was really like geared up to do it, and her commander came by and hit her on the chest but missed the pin on purpose. So, you know, there's definitely, for a ritual to be successful, everyone has to engage it collectively, and part of what happens in these transitional times is women are still kind of being treated differently, being set aside in a different way. So, yes.
So I love this presentation. So fascinating to kind of get to see so many different rituals and learn from your perspective on them as well. So I'm struck by the title of your talk, which is Rituals for Resilience. And so resilience can, of course, mean so many things, right? Personal resilience, you know, familial resilience, community resilience, et cetera. And your last comment and a few of the examples throughout sort of indicate the way in which resilience can be used to reify social inequality and structural harms that we recognize around society. And so I'm wondering if you might have a critique of this resilience concept and construct that comes out of your field, or if there is, if you can offer any thoughts on the ways in which ritual, I'm even thinking of the sort of India example where women get to beat the men, because at the end of the day, I mean, it's sort of a joke, right? Because the implication is that men are always going to still be dominant. So, mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering if you could offer reflections on that and the ways in which resilience can reify structural inequality.
Absolutely, and I think that's an excellent point because, you know, we always say that, of course, when we're observing a culture or we're designing a research program, it's so much of it in anthropology is in the eye of the beholder. Mm-hmm. So if you're talking about resilience, that's such a broad concept as to be meaningless until you put it into the framework of, you know, looking at pluralistic societies, being resilient against whatever it is. You could most definitely make the argument that there are rituals that help white supremacists feel more resilient, right? Feel more in charge and able to confront the horrifying diversity of the world out there. So there's nothing, resilience is in many ways just a neutral term, and it's exactly as you say. And rituals are neutral as well. It's what the society chooses to do with them. So I would say if you have a particular perspective of resilience which embodies a certain cultural narrative of healing and stability, you need to articulate that explicitly. Because then the rituals and the rites of passage would need to address that or work towards achieving that vision of resilience.
Thank you very much for your talk. We thoroughly enjoyed it. Just have a quick question. So do you ascribe merit to like individual rituals, you know, that are like maybe practiced by more than one person but not collectively, kind of like brushing your teeth or something, in bolstering collective resilience to shocks? Thank you.
No, and I think that not all rituals have anything to do with the sort of larger uncertainties or resilience, except in the sense that it probably makes you feel like all is right with the world. Like, you know, you go to bed without brushing your teeth when you're used to doing it every night, and you're like, just something feels wrong. Very emotional. So yes, definitely there are some rituals that are going to do that explicitly. There are some that are going to do that incidentally. And then there's some that really aren't going to do that very much.
You mentioned about we are planning to create new rituals. So I'm interested to say that how the whole system would like make sure the organization will, who are gonna shape the new rituals, they keep their work like effectively?
Yeah, I mean that's a great question, because it relies on, first of all, when you said the society, so what are you talking about, a nation state, right? And it's particularly relevant in the United States at the moment, which is so divided into factions. So if you imagine the federal government creating a ritual and we're all going to participate in it and we're all going to be happy, there's just no way, that would fail immediately. That said, we still do have these kind of existing rituals around governance that we at least adhere to or give lip service to, you know, the inauguration of the president. We might be upset about it, but we don't necessarily want to dismantle the inauguration itself. So I think when you're also, it seems like, talking a little bit about control over the direction that the ritual would go into. And that's, you know, as an anthropologist, we're always on the ground. We're always like with the practitioners rather than somebody who's trying to construct a ritual. And it's always fascinating for us to see how something might be transformed in ways that you wouldn't expect. And for something to be meaningful, it has to really connect with the participants. So if someone tries to force a ritual, unless that overlaps really well with the ideology and the practices of the group that's participating in, you're going to see multiple ways in which that ritual is going to branch off and be practiced. So the best I could say is that if you are thinking of designing a ritual for this purpose, you would have to consult the people who are going to be the ones performing it, the group of interest. It would have to come from there in order to be successful.
Going back to the title, I think it is a fascinating title, Rituals of Resilience. I'm thinking of a climate adaptation point of view. Are there examples where you've seen the practice of resilience or the framing of resilience becoming ritualized?
Mm-hmm.
And are there, you know, what are the pros and cons of that?
That's a great question. And I think you don't really have to look farther than hipster Boston to see that. Just go for Life Alive in Cambridge to see rituals of resilience. I mean, the organic food movement, the ways in which people are, you know, anti-vaccine or pro solar panels or whatever, you know, there's an underlying ideology about it, but there are ways in which like rituals are growing up around that and kind of collective practices around that as well. But then you can also see groups who are losing their land and having to make really tough decisions about their ancestral lands that are being taken over by encroaching water. And they're having to make decisions about how to relocate in a way that preserves who they are while losing this attachment to the physical land that they have had for so long. And that's really tough, but that's happening right now. Like those kinds of creations are happening right now. So I'm not sure if that addresses what you're speaking of. But.
Thank you so much. My question is about the difference between procedures and rituals.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to be an emotional connection to rituals, which is not part of procedures, because they all are about uncertainty, and procedures give us more certainty than rituals do. And so how does emotions differ between procedures? And
that's a good question. I guess it also perhaps depends on how you're defining procedure versus ritual. I think some procedures can be very ritualistic, but then also if you are
standard operating procedures, you know.
Right. I think that they can become adapted in some ways as rituals, particularly if you imagine, you know, a surgeon like washing their hands in a particular way and that helping them mentally to prepare. So I think that there can be a pretty good overlap there. Part of it though is that there has to be an acknowledgement that what you're doing is important. So if you have procedures and you're just kind of going through them because that's what it says, then there isn't going to be the same emotional engagement, you know, if you're following a computer manual, for example.
Okay, one more question.
With the ceremonies in England, do you know if they're inclusive ceremonies? Or so are they like native English, or are they including all the new migrant populations in them?
That's a really good question. My understanding is that the early revitalizations of them were not necessarily oriented that way. They were about kind of reinstituting village life, and that got defined in very particular ways. But now that it's become more popularly done and it's kind of spread out throughout other parts of England, I think it really varies from place to place. But yeah, there was a little bit of, there was a little tinge of isolationism in that, that was exactly what Darian Smith was picking up on.
Thank you so much, Professor Hirsch. We have two more talks in the series all around Tuesdays at 4 p.m. Let's get back to season. Thank you.